Well, good morning. It's wonderful to see you this morning. You may have noticed on your seats coming in, there's one of those blue Get Connected cards. We are going to this morning make a concerted effort to get updated on information and people's information. And so you might have noticed in the foyer there's a sign up for the directory to have your name in the directory. If you're not in the directory, you can go ahead and sign up out there this morning. But we would like everybody, even if you've been here for 20 years or longer, to fill out a Get Connected card. And there's pens around. There's not one on every seat, but so you might have to share. But if you can go ahead and put your name, phone number, some information on there, we will get everything updated in our directory. And this is just a wonderful, I'm in the directory constantly, and I know that there's a lot of people who use the directory as a prayer tool and pray through there, and it's just a great way in a growing church to kind of know who all is there and be praying for people and how to get in touch with people. And so we're just going to take a couple minutes right now to go ahead and fill this out. Bill, you have a question. Yeah, sure. So we're really making an effort to make sure nobody in our church falls through the cracks, especially as we're growing. And one of the ways that we do that is through shepherding. And so there are elders or growth group leaders who are in charge of keeping in touch with a group of people, see how they're doing. If they haven't been around for a while, maybe something's happened or going on, and there's someone that is there specifically to notice and say, hey, how are you doing? Anything we can be praying for you about and checking in on people. And so it's just one way we can take care of the flock and love our neighbor, love the people around us. And we'd hate for anybody to just kind of feel unnoticed on accident and slip through the cracks. And so this is one way that we'll do that. And this is one way we can have information to help us do that well. And so even if you've been here a long time, we'd love for you to fill this out. Yeah, I think that'd be great. So in the questions, comments, if you can put your address and phone number, you can put your email. That's all information that goes into the directory. If you have any comments, go ahead and put them in there, or prayer requests. You may notice in your bulletin, if you are more digitally inclined, there's one of those QR codes that looks like your TV went out and is all fuzzy. You could take a picture of it with your phone, and that will link you directly to an online, or right behind me there's one on the screen too. And that will send you to our website where you can update your information online as well. And so while you're filling those out, you can just hold on to it, and when the offering bag gets passed around later, you can just stick it in there, and we'll collect them all. And Carrie, our office administrator, has been doing a fantastic job of updating information. It's a huge job. We have Chris Kroll's put together a large database with, growth groups people are in, different Bible studies people are in, contact information, shepherds who's connected, and it's a wonderful tool. So thank you for helping us get that updated. While you're finishing up, just filling out information on there, I have a couple more announcements. Last night, we had a wonderful auction for our Mexico mission trip. We raised enough money just by the auction alone to fully send almost 5.8 people to Mexico. So it was great. It was a lot of fun, a good turnout. Talisha Cooper and Roe Yancey did an amazing amount of work to pull that off, and it went off without a hitch. So they were fantastic, and they're not going on the trip, but they are helping so much in the fundraising aspect. And so just be praying for them and their families. Ro is taking a trip to Mexico as well this summer, just not the same trip as us. So They've been great, and we had a good time. And the last announcement is just a reminder that there's no shepherding meeting today after second service. It is March 26th after second service. March 26th, we will be doing a shepherding. So if you're a growth group leader or an elder or on the shepherding team, you are invited to come to that meeting on March 26th after the second service. All right, with that, would you stand? And we're going to get started with worship today.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe. There's nothing impossible.
Battle beat.
Father, we thank you that your love never fails. We thank you that you have shown it to us in Jesus Christ. So just help us by your Spirit to comprehend and to see more of Jesus and to understand your love, the depths of which we can't fully fathom, but just give us more understanding, Lord. Thank you that your love has been poured out into our hearts through your Holy Spirit that's been given to us. Thank you, Jesus, that while we were still sinners, you died on a cross to save us from our sins. So I just pray this morning as we worship together that our hearts would be knit together by the Spirit as brothers and sisters, called into your family by a love that never fails and never ends. Thank you that you don't give up on us. We deserve that, but you are faithful. And just as you are unchangeable and eternal and strong and faithful, Lord, your love is like you, and it goes on, and it doesn't end. And thank you for that. We love you because you first loved us. And Lord, we want to lift up and love our brother and sister, Steve and Deidre Nothern, this morning as we pray for them. And Just ask your blessing on their life. We ask for the next few months that you would really give them peace and lead them. They ask for thankfulness as they navigate the next few months. So just work in their hearts that they would be thankful in all circumstances. And Lord, we pray as they travel and do construction that there would just be safety and your hand on them. They ask for opportunities to serve others. And Lord, I think that is right in line with your heart for us, that we would be servants and love those around us. And so give them opportunities to serve and boldness to take them when they're there, and help them to do it with cheerful, thankful hearts. And thank you for the blessing in their life. And now as we take our offering, we just pray that you would bless and multiply and be honored and worshiped with our giving. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Word became flesh and light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, bearing he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. One day he's come. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. One day the grave could conceal him no longer, one day the stone rolled away from the door, then he arose, over death he had conquered, now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified. One day he's coming, oh glorious.
Thank you guys for leading us and for showing up an extra hour earlier than early for your practices and your service, both those of you up front as well as James and Josh in the back. We love and appreciate your service. And we have one really important matter to discuss, and it's a serious matter. And to represent that, I'm going to put on the sombrero right here. And it is Mary Shabo's birthday yesterday. And I think it's probably important that we would sing to her. Would someone with a better voice than mine lead us out?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Amen. Yes, and one of her early birthday gifts was a special reel to fish for halibut. So this coming season, so that's nice. We love you, Mary. We love you, and we're grateful for you, who you are, and for loving Mike. We know that's takes some forbearance. No, I love Mike too. Yes. But no, just your heart for Christ and your love for his church and this community and your testimony and story. I don't know if everybody's heard it, but it's beautiful, like all testimonies. So, yeah. Oh, wait, I'll take the sombrero off in just a second. I don't know if it's intentional or not that the numbers don't get shared. I think it's worthy of noting that at the time last night that we had for the auction, it was over $8,000 that came in. I mean, that's special. That's special. It was overwhelming to see, just to see the generosity from you. And then also, I don't know how many people, 150 people, 200 people, and over half of them weren't regular attenders here at the church. And they showed up to support family members and friends. Many of those weren't believers, but they got a picture of the gospel last night, and that's a special thing. And it's quite positive that there's probably closer to $10,000 that was given, because that $8,000 only what came in the auction. It doesn't include all the individual donations that went on the table, as well as separate gifts that came online. So it's a special time. It's a special time, and so we're excited to see what's happening there. I'm going to take this off now because I look like a dork, we'll kind of jump in here. There's a few other things I think I'm supposed to mention. Oh yeah, so this week, be in prayer for the weather, because the excavation crew is due to start excavating the foundation on Tuesday for the new facility. So Chris just asked that we would pray for that. And also, as that foundation is going in and being poured, you have 2 days to get any tiles. If you would like to write a scripture verse or a prayer or write a hymn, you can do that. Those are out in the foyer. Just write on those with a Sharpie that is provided there, and that'll get laid into the foundation as a representation that Christ is our cornerstone and he is our foundation. And that building is for his glory and his kingdom building, and so keep that in mind. But also note that most all of you, and if you haven't received a email or text from our very dear Sue, Sue, raise your hand. So this is Sue. She's our volunteer coordinator, and I got the text. If you're available to help, just give her a heads up so that she can start putting schedules together. And I totally forgot until, I think it was maybe last night or the night before, I was driving and I told one of my kids, hey, oh, text Sue Darrell real quick because I've got to get back to her. But we will have the need for all of us to be involved in the project, especially once the foundation is cured and we're starting to set things up. So look for those things. Don't ignore those. If you're not able to help out, just reply to her either through a text or a phone call and just say you're not available or you are only are available this day. Because is anything else on that, Sue? Okay. Thank you for that. It's and Joellen knows this too, it's tough to herd the cats, if I can call us that, to get these projects done. But it's really going to ramp up, just in God's timing. So exciting stuff there. All right, let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your gift of one another, your gift of your church. We thank you for the gift of salvation and freedom that we have through our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the gift of being entrusted with the work of your kingdom and entrusted with being your disciples. And Father, we would ask that through our time today in your word, you would grow each and every one of us more into the image, into the likeness of Christ. We know, Lord, that we were made in your Trinitarian image, and we are grateful for that. Be honored and glorified this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We are in a series titled POD, which is Portrait of a Disciple. And this is a framework, a tool, just like money is a tool or a wrench is a tool. It's a tool to help us stay focused where we as a church need to be focused in. There's always so many things that happen and are going on, and it's easy to run 1,000 different directions. But we want to make sure that we are focused in the right directions. And so we have these 6 components that the leadership here came up with after a long workshop of working together a couple years ago. And this is a preaching series to highlight those elements. None of these elements are laid out for the purpose of giving any of us a guilt complex or to feel shame. Because if you read our one-page document, actually it's two pages, front and back, one page front and back, so 2 pages, it can seem overwhelming. And it is overwhelming. And that's okay. It's okay because Jesus is the picture of perfection when it comes to that portrait of a disciple. And yet we, in the sanctification process, when we were saved and given the Holy Spirit, we began a journey. And we are, in essence, we are running a race. We are soldiers. We are brothers and sisters. And we are still in this flesh, and we will not do it perfectly. So none of this should be something that would be discouraging as we go through it. I'm not going to recap the first 5. You can see the list at the top of your bulletin on the inside. There's the 6. You'll see the one that's today. It's circled. It's family-focused. And this is a two-parter. It's a two-parter because I don't feel like we can do justice to this element or this portrait piece in one Sunday. So we're going to do focused on marriage today, and then next week we're focusing on parenting, because those two things are integrated into this family-focused purpose. But I want to just say it from the front. Marriage, biblical marriage, is beautiful. It is God's design for a very specific purpose, and it's his direction, it's his guidelines which define what marriage is. And no more so, I think, today than any other day, marriage is under great attack from our enemy. Because we know that a healthy picture of marriage is a healthy picture of Christ's love for his church. It's a proclamation of the gospel if we live in a biblically focused marriage. And when that gets skewed, then our witness as followers of Christ can be greatly diminished or tarnished. So we need to know that. There are things that most likely this morning will ruffle your feathers a little bit. I'm fine with that. I'm fine with that because I'm not speaking my own words. This is God's word that defines what marriage is and how marriage is to function. And it's beautiful. But it's been so perverted by our culture, it seems like we would be, it can ruffle feathers. And I need you to be okay. I do ask that you stay to the end. Please don't leave early. I mean, if you have to use a restroom, give me a hand signal or something so I know you're not leaving before time. No, I'm joking. But in any case, I don't need to go into this too much more, but marriage is a special gift from God, and I realize not everyone in here is married, and maybe never will be, or they've lost a spouse, or they're in a divorce situation, or on a second marriage or third marriage, and that is okay. This message is for all of us. It's not just for those people who are married or who are going to get married. This is a message for every one of us, regardless of our history with marriage or our understanding of marriage. It's really about discipleship more than it's about the marriage relationship, and you'll see that as we go. Our verses this morning are coming. It's two short verses. Many of you know these verses by heart. And go ahead and turn to the book of Genesis, chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. I'll turn to. Reading from God's holy scriptures, Genesis chapter 2, verses 24 and 25. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Amen. Marriage, what is it? Well, first off, let me just start. The overriding big idea here is that marriage is a covenant. Marriage is a covenant. That's the big idea here. And stealing from our fearless elder chairman, Tom, I called him to look at his dictionary definition because he has a good old dictionary and I didn't. And a covenant, what is covenant from just a dictionary definition? It is this. It is a mutual consent or agreement of two or more persons to do or to forbear some act or thing. This is a mutual consent. Now, this is important. A mutual consent, and it's important for where we're going. We're going to define it a little further in just a moment. But overall, marriage is a covenant as God laid it out. And marriage also is something beautiful. It is God's answer to one of the greatest human problems. And that human problem or difficulty is loneliness. I really believe that one of the great beauties of God's church is that it attacks loneliness. When we talk about putting in our information into a card, and many of you are like, I've gone to this church for a long time. Why do you want my information? Well, part of it is we just want to update our records because we need to do that. But also the reason we have the act of all of us doing it this morning is because there's new people that are here and the Lord's brought them here. And if they see all of us filling out a card, then maybe they don't feel like they're the only one and they're isolated and they're different than everybody else. So it's just an act that we do together. But marriage was designed in large part to solve the problem of loneliness, that man should not be alone. So God created a helper suitable for that. And so what does marriage look like? It's simple, but it's profound. It's beautiful, but it's not easy. The first portion in your notes, it says, they must, this is speaking of those being married, they must leave. They must leave. The two leave their parents and they form a new primary loyalty, a loyalty that is for each other. And the point isn't that necessarily they would move far away, although sometimes that's the best thing. What the point is they would shift their loyalty from their parents to their spouse. This is their primary loyalty now. The husband to the wife and the wife to the husband, rather than to the father and to the mother. And the spouse becomes the very most important person. And this just might seem like a mundane point. Let's get on to point two. But it doesn't work that way often in our culture. Too often, the husband and the wife don't fully leave and cleave or leave their loyalty and join it to their spouse, they remain somewhat connected to a parent or both parents. And certainly that relationship is always going to be important, but in this particular case, what we're seeing here is that it is now our job as men and as women to leave and to stay primarily loyal to our wife. So in some cases, this means that men, you are now to defend and protect your wife from your parents or from her parents and vice versa for women. There is a need for, and sometimes, protection for you, because oftentimes, and I am getting close to that stage of life where my kids will one day be leaving, and I know how hard that is, but God says that they are to leave and join to their new loyalty, and that new loyalty is more important than me, which is hard for me to take. That's hard to even think about. But it's important. And so this means when maybe one of your children who has been married comes to you with something negative towards their spouse because they're hurt, you as a parent need to gently, possibly, or directly, possibly, let them know that their primary loyalty. You remember your vows? It was to your spouse. There's obviously certain situations, I say this often, where there's legitimate abuse involved. And in those cases, that's a different playbook. But most of the time, it's not. And so we have to, as parents, help our kids honor that original loyalty, and as those getting married, or our grandkids, or our nieces and nephews, or if you're a friend of someone that is married, maybe some of you have friends that are married, and they come to you to gripe, it is your job not to receive that. Your job is to point them back to their primary loyalty, because they have made a covenant to leave. It was a mutual agreement. They chose to leave, and that's important to recognize. No one forced their hand, at least in our culture, to marry this person. They made that choice. So they must leave. They also must, verse 24, the middle of it, is they must hold fast. They must hold fast. Some of your translations may say cleave, but these are two people that have pronounce their primary loyalty to one another, and they are now to hold fast. They are to hold fast, meaning they permanently stick together from that point forward. It's a beautiful picture, and it's a choice that they have done. They have chosen to leave. They've made a covenantal vow to leave and to hold fast, or to cleave to their wife in this particular context, and obviously as well to their husband. We are permanently gluing ourselves to our spouse. And there is no dissolving this. It's too easy today to dissolve these joining together. And what you're saying when you're in this place is that you're going to be, yes, faithful to God, faithful to your vow, faithful to your calling as a spouse, faithful to your spouse, faithful to the relationship. And this means a vital change in perspective and definition of what marriage is. And it goes back to the beginning of, and it's repeated here in your notes, that you are choosing to covenant yourself before the Lord with your spouse, because marriage is a covenant. Stressing covenant here because it is not a contract. Marriage is not a contract. It's not a title that gives you some particular, I don't know why, this just popped in my mind, but Josh is back in the sound booth, and it's scary when things pop in my mind, but I vividly remember your wedding, you and Heather, 20 years ago? 18 years ago, and I did something very inappropriate in the wedding. You know me, you can see how I can do that, and I used the illustration of my boat title. I had just gotten a boat for my grandfather, and he gave me the title, and I have this possession now. And I love this possession. But that is not marriage. Marriage isn't a piece of paper that you sign, and now you have some kind of ownership over. You and I don't serve our spouses in a contractual type of way. It's a covenantal relationship. And by that, what that means is that you have committed yourself to covering one another. And this is the second half of defining what covenant is. Covenant is like an umbrella. If you just look at it like this, it's a covering. And you and I, this time of year, we're starting to maybe, well, not today, but uncover some of the things that have been covered up by tarps. When we're uncovering our gardens or uncovering wood piles and getting ready for some seasoning of those things in the sun, maybe someday. And that's what covenant is. It is providing a covering. Let me just read the definition again from Tom's dictionary. It is a laying over. It is spreading over a surface. It is also to conceal. It is to envelope. It is to shelter. It is to protect. It is to conceal. It is to screen. It is a safety zone. That's what marriage is. You're covenanting one another to one another as a covenant that would cover or seal or secure or take care of, not to contractually keep a person or a spouse in a particular place, but to protect, to provide a safe place and let that relationship flourish. Marriage is a covenant. It's not like your phone plan that when you don't like it, you can switch to another provider. I was going to use the illustration of it's not like your internet provider, but for those of us out here, we pretty much have one option, and we all would love to switch. At least I would love to switch from CenturyLink, but I'm not willing to pay for Starlink, which is the only other option. So you have terrible service or you have expensive service. It's just not a good option. But the idea is we have it in a culture that when you don't like something, you can just trade it in. And that is so not the picture of marriage as God has beautifully designed it from the beginning. So marriage is not a contract. We don't enter marriage to get something from it. That is not the purpose. That is not God's call for marriage. You don't enter it to get something out of it. It is a covenant relationship. And this is pictured by God, who is in a covenant relationship with us. When we, by faith, received the grace God offered to us from the Lord Jesus Christ, we entered into a covenant, an agreement with him, an agreement that we are adopted into his family. We are heirs of his kingdom eternally. He is never getting out of the relationship, and guess what? He doesn't get what is due him from us, and yet he is faithful. We have this all in common. None of us are faithful to our covenantal relationship with the Lord. He is always and always has been and will be faithful to us. And that is a great picture of an encouragement for us as we look at the covenant of marriage. It's not a contract. It's permanent. It's joining ourselves together. It's holding fast. Thirdly, the two shall become one flesh. And I intentionally did this with the words. I think it's up there. It should be. Oh, it's not. In your notes, it should be together. Together, one flesh. I mean, is it a compound word? I wanted those things to be together to illustrate one flesh. It's not one independent and then flesh, another word. It's one flesh. Compound word. So stick those two words together in your notes. We now function as spouses as one. And the reason this is important is we're not warring against each other. Not in a biblical way. We're not to war against each other. We're not to pull against each other. This is a picture of oneness. We unite together. We unite together physically, sexually, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. This is a picture of what it is to be completely giving to ourselves. We are to become one flesh without reservation, without concern. Nothing holds us back in our marriage. Our bodies are not held back. Our emotions are not held back. Our affections are not held back. We give ourselves completely to the other person. This is the picture of marriage that God has given us. And we're uniquely designed as men and women to complement each other. This is another reason why we as followers of Christ in the culture today need to stand firm, hold fast to the biblical truth of gender as God has assigned it. He's assigned it and made it this way for a purpose. We are to complement, to complete one another. It is not one is better than the other or one is more important than the other. We each have different roles and jobs, and we're to hold fast to those particular roles, and we're designed that way. Now, we can see this in verse 25. It says, the man and his wife were both naked, and they were unashamed. They were not ashamed, naked and unashamed. There's nothing here to hide. The picture that God has for us in marriage is that there's nothing to hide from each other. So with that, there's no reason to feel shame from one another. Now, we live in a fallen world. We live in a world after Adam and Eve went to sow fig leaves on to hide their nakedness. But still, the picture that God gave us is that there's not to be any shame in our relationship. No exposure. We don't exploit one another. In marriage, we are one another's safe place, safe landing place, where nothing is hidden, nothing is covered, nothing is held back. There's no fear of being exposed in any way. The complete you is on display, and there is no shame because we have entered into a oneness, one flesh relationship. And this is not the case in most marriages. There's a lot of shame. There's a lot of regret. There's a lot of pain. There's a lot of covering ourselves with fig leaves in marriage relationships, and that needs to be dealt with. That is not God's picture of marriage. It is not his picture of marriage. We are to hold fast to our oneness in our relationship. And there's to be protection there, safety there in marriage, naked and unashamed before each other without shame. Sadly, most marriages don't, they may start this way, but they don't continue this way because we're sinful people. And we buy into a culture that says, no, I need to keep me important. And we shouldn't be surprised that both men and women are human, that they bring in their human weakness and sinfulness into marriage, and the sin as well as drives us apart. But that's not God's picture. And so that kind of leads to where we're going to wrap up today. And it's worthy to note, and I think this is important to picture, is that God here commands us to leave, to hold fast and become one flesh. These aren't suggestions for us as his children. These are actual commands. And we need to know, if we don't already know, and I think most of us do know, we just don't like to know when we don't want to do what we ought must do. And that is this. We need a command because sometimes things don't come natural. And marriage is the picture of that. It does not seem natural. If it was natural and easy to do these things, they wouldn't be commands. You don't have to tell me to eat a meal. It comes pretty natural to me. But God's picture of marriage and why he commands this is because it doesn't come natural. And guess what? That is to your benefit and to his glory. When we obey, submit ourselves to God and his plan, then we receive the benefit from it. But when we think we have our own plan, like our culture does with marriage, seeing it as transactional, seeing it as something that I get from and for it, and I'll be first to admit, at least I've got the microphone, so I will. You know, I didn't enter marriage. I had an amazing sermon at my marriage by my soon-to-be father-in-law. And our home pastor also helped us make vows, but I still, even with the truth of growing up in a Christian home and even having good examples on both sides of our family, I still went into marriage thinking, I'm going to get something out of this. And that caused a lot of heartache and frankly still causes some heartache when I let my old nature that we've talked about get in the way. Marriage isn't there for us to get something from it. And just to drive this point home, because this is the point that will make people shudder in our culture today, I want us to turn to the book of 1 Peter. Please turn to 1 Peter. We're actually going to start in chapter 2. Our primary two verses are in chapter 3, but I want to give some context to chapter 3, because chapter 3 starts out with likewise. So you can jump in your Bibles, chapter 2 of 1 Peter. I'm going to read a few of these, and I realize I'm leaving a lot out, which should be an indicator that you should spend some time in your personal devotions this week, looking up maybe this whole chapter. And it's this. We'll just start out at verse 9 of chapter 2. It says this: "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Verse 12, "Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." Verses 13 through 17, "Be subject," this is where you need to start really tuning into the language here, "be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor." Now, let's jump to verse 18. "Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust." Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. It gives some reasoning there, but then with that in mind, let's jump to verse 1 of chapter 3. "Likewise," and I, just so you know, I'm talking to the wives first, and that's because it comes up in the text, and wives and women, don't worry, we're going to get to the husbands in a moment. "Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even when some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their lives." This verse here in 1 Peter and also in other areas of Scripture instructs wives to place themselves under the authority and leadership of their husbands. As we talked about earlier, this is two becoming one, and this two becoming one means that they do not war against each other or pull in opposite directions of one another. In marriage, you've entered a covenant. You have made a choice declaring to your husband and to the world that you will submit to his leadership. This is where it bristles, feathers a little bit. This is where a lot of things come to mind. I'm going to stick to my notes for the moment. This is a command again because it's not easy for women. It's not easy for women. And we can look back to the beginning of our Christian story. It's not easy for women to submit to leadership. And I'll stick to my notes. This means that women, that you, now some of you are already married, and not so much in first service, but this still applies to all of us. Think about it from this perspective. You must pick a man, if you are going to get married, that you can trust. You must gauge a man by the degree in which you can yield to him. He must be trustworthy. If he is not, don't marry him. Doesn't matter how much success he has. It doesn't matter how much money he has, how good looking he is, how established he is in his church or in his community. If you cannot yield yourself to him, do not marry him. For the two are to become one. They're two that must understand oneness. And so wives, this is where you choose submission. Wives make the choice. They put themselves under his leadership, yielding to him. And the apostle also says they'll yield to their husband even if he's not a believer. I think this is beautiful. And we have many, many, both men and women in our congregation that are not married to a believing spouse. And yet, the Lord still calls you to yield to him. Now, you might say, well, I'm already married. I've already made this choice. And I didn't realize that I needed to make this commitment when I made my covenant of marriage. And this is a person in which I do not feel is worthy of yielding to. Get over it. It's not for you to make that decision. This is God's word. This is what he calls you as women to do, to submit and to yield. And that can be hard when your husband is like me and every other man at times in their lives, immature, not worthy of your yielding. There's no clause here for you. There's no clause for you to take the reins. Now, that we're all uncomfortable, men. Men, you're addressed in verse 7. Let's read verse 7. Likewise, husbands. Well, he's giving us a different directive here, a different command. What does he mean, likewise? Well, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. There's a lot in that verse. Let's break it down just a moment, for just a moment. And we'll put the heading, well, I don't want to put the heading like this just yet. Wives, I just want to speak to you. You might say, well, that seems easy. That doesn't seem like it's a hard thing. Why can't we have an easy, you know, it's hard to submit. For men, I would say, looking back to the story of Adam and Eve, for men, it's pretty easy to submit. We might not show it on the surface, but men, it's easy for us because our culture promotes this to turn us into spineless people, spineless men. So submission for men is easy. It feels more natural, at least in this old nature, the flesh. What is very hard for us as men is to live with our wives in an understanding way. I would say it's equally as difficult. Well, I know it's equally as difficult because I am a man. It is difficult to live with my wife in an understanding way and to show her honor in an understanding way. This has been perverted in Christianity for years and years, and that perversion has caused a culture to misinterpret what the beautiful picture of marriage is to be. But men, your job isn't to bring home the bacon, according to this passage. Your job isn't to go slay a dragon, although that is part of your job in some senses. Your job is to live with your wife in an understanding way, and it's heartbreaking for the picture of so many women that are so alone in their marriages, because they have husbands that are so caught up in their careers, their toys, their hobbies. I'll just say it, their motorcycles, their hunting, their tools, their sin, their addictions, their substances. It is hard for men to live in an understanding way, but men, you better do that, because that is what God has called you to do. It's what he's called me to do. Your number one aim, according to the word here, and according to the leaving, the holding fast and becoming one flesh, is that you are more interested in understanding your wife, in whom you should know you will never fully understand. But this is God's design. It's beautiful to know that the person that I have covenanted myself with is a person that has so many facets that are so beautiful, far more beautiful than any diamond that this earth could create, that I get an opportunity to understand her, to see her. So many women do not see, are not seen because our culture, and frankly too many husbands, buy into the package, the picture, the aesthetics. That's horrifying. Our wives need to be seen. Our wives need to be heard. Our wives need to be understood. And for us as husbands, we are to make this our number one aim. This is the most important relationship that God has blessed us with, is our wives. Whether you think it or not, this is it. And too many of us live opposite of that. And that's to your detriment, men. That's to your detriment. But if you, as a man, understand your wife, seek to hear her heart, to cherish her, to be her soft landing place, in whatever stage of life she is in, let me tell you, God designed her to flourish in that. And that is really what leadership in the home is like. Too often, and through different seasons of the church, this was the man makes the decisions and the wife must listen. That is the worst interpretation of God's design of a beautiful marriage. As a matter of fact, if you're making decisions and you're not consulting your wife, shame on you. You are partners. Scripture here says a weaker vessel. It does not say a lesser vessel. And the reality is, women are weaker in a lot of senses, physically in most senses. Look at the chaos that's going on with transgender sports right now, and guys getting in girls' swimsuits and competing against girls and winning every time. I mean, it's simple biology. But more important than that, is God designed men and women to be a team together. Julie and I always say this in our premarital counseling. Don't forget, you're on the same team. You shouldn't be pulling in opposite directions. But God has given us a picture. And that picture is that the wife is to submit, and husbands, oh, I didn't even give you the last word. Husbands, you choose crucifixion. Wives, in covenanting to their husband, choose submission. Husbands, you have chosen crucifixion. You have chosen to put your needs aside for the understanding, the honor, the benefit of your spouse. And this is where it's beautiful. This is where a marriage, as God designed it for us, and a lot of people would, well, let me finish that thought. This is where marriage is one of the most beautiful proclamations of the gospel. The working of Christ. Christ did this. Christ submitted himself to his Father's will. He didn't want to in his humanity to take the cross, but he submitted to his Father's will, and he died. And he died for us. He was crucified. And this is the picture that we have in marriage. Marriage emulates this, submission and crucifixion. And if we as husbands and wives are operating this way, this is the most beautiful, intimate, refreshing marriage. Don't make excuses for your covenant choice in your marriage. Don't make excuses. This is a high call, and it's a beautiful call for us. Men and women in our congregation, it's a beautiful call. For those who are not married or have gone through divorce or loss of a spouse. This is still a picture, a model of relationship and how we as either men or women are to conduct ourselves. We are still to conduct ourselves in this way, first and foremost to the Lord, and then also to the other people in our lives. I see a lot of this amongst you. I see a lot of us crucifying our own desires and needs for the body of Christ. And we'll see more and more of it as we do a project together very soon. Well, it's a project that's been ongoing, but it's going to take shape soon. I see it occasionally in marriages. I just wouldn't want in our body to have any marriages that are miserable because we don't honor the covenant that we've chosen. And if you want to right the ship, if you're miserable in your marriage, get your eyes off of the other person. Live up to your call, your command from God to either submit or to be crucified. This is a joy. This is what God has given us, and this is what your heart longs for. It longs for this intimacy, this partnership, whether it's in marriage or whether it's within the church family. Would you please stand as we pray, as you are able? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your beautiful design for marriage. We thank you for your beautiful design for your church. We thank you, Jesus, that you submitted to your Father's will and you bore the weight of all of our sin through your crucifixion on the cross. And we thank you, Father, that you have loved us so perfectly. We thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice that makes us holy in the Father's sight, not because we have been the perfect spouse, but because you have been the perfect picture of a perfect spouse. We thank you that there is forgiveness. We thank you that there is joy and hope. We thank you that there is freedom. Father, I pray, and Holy Spirit, I ask that you would empower us as a church, those who were married, to live biblical marriages, to push back in a Christ-honoring, Scripture-glorifying way the tide of culture that makes marriage about me and not about the other person. Give us strength in this as we are weak vessels. We have our own flesh and our own ways. Help us to release forgiveness quickly to one another, both in marriage as well as with inside the church. We love you. We thank you. Be glorified. In this we pray. Amen. Amen. I'll just make one mention too. I meant to start out with this, but it is coming up on the Easter season, resurrection season, and as a church body, we are trying to kind of clear the decks with busyness and programs. We're not doing any really specialized outreach events like we normally do, because we want, as a church body and as a whole, to look to the Easter Sunday as our church-wide outreach efforts. And so we want to challenge, the elders got together Tuesday to start talking through this. We just want to challenge the whole congregation to be intentional about inviting at least one person that you know, that doesn't know the Lord or is not walking with the Lord, to a Sunday service. And we're going to set aside some special times of prayer and fasting that we'll get on the calendar this week, and we'll let you know. But this is what the people around you need. They need to walk alongside others who are walking this life, looking to live by God's design and serve and love in God's ways. And so just keep that in thought and prayer, and there'll be more instructions on how we're going to do that as a church. We are going to have a Good Friday service as well. That's the only other event outside of our prayer and fasting that we're going to do as a church officially this year. So with that, I've already prayed, so I'll just say amen and I'll get off the stage. Let's sing together. Amen.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come. And I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
I'd like to close by reading part of Psalm 34. It's a way to encourage you to be in God's word as you look at the week ahead of you. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul will make its boast in the Lord. The humble will hear it and rejoice. Exalt the Lord with me. And let's exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he answered me and rescued me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces will never be ashamed. This wretched man cried out and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and rescues them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Let's live that way this week.